Hallelujah, where would I be? Hallelujah. I would have fainted. Hallelujah, I would have given up. Hallelujah, if I had not lived and believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Glory, my shield and my buckler, my high tower from the enemy. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God. Bless your name forevermore. Hallelujah. Will your people gather together, Father, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. We gather to worship, to praise you, to acknowledge your presence in this place. Hallelujah. We thank you for the power of your presence. Your word is anointed. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Your word is true from the very beginning. We thank you for the gospel of Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Savior. Hallelujah. The magnificent one, the excellent one. We gather to give him praise. We thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, let all the people say amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God.
Lord, is God good this morning? Hallelujah. Can I get an amen? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, bless his name. Let's just go before him. Hallelujah. The presence of the Lord is here. Hallelujah. Moving in the atmosphere. Hey, thank you, Lord. Let me hear your voice this morning. Hallelujah. God, we worship you. Hallelujah. Thank you, God.
Yeah.
Jesus. Come on, I'm praying for somebody's breakthrough. Come on, call on your name, Jesus. Korabashi, korabase, romande, korabashi, romande, se korabesi, komaniye, se korabase, korabase, romande, korabashi, romase, korabase, romase. We call on the name of Jesus. Oh!
Hallelujah. Say hallelujah. in God and how it brings salvation and it brings purity and it lifts your spirit. And when you just begin to magnify God and you begin to see all that He is in your life, all of a sudden your problems don't seem like problems at all. And you remember how big He is, and you remember all the miracles that He's done, and you see Him even in this present day. When I see my babies crying out to God, unrestrained and unprompted. You know, it's so many Sundays when it's tiring working in the children's ministry, and you wonder, did they hear you? Are they listening? How many times do I have to say, sit down? Stop talking. Leave it alone. Don't hit her. But when the Spirit hits them, it's all worth it. It's all worth it because you know that's what brings salvation. But not only them, but their whole household. That's what brings salvation. Hallelujah. So it's hard for me to stop because they're still worshiping. They see us praising and worshiping, they'll praise and worship. If they see us magnifying the Lord, then they know they're supposed to magnify the Lord. But how can we teach them to praise and worship the Lord when we sit and act like we're not moved and unaffected? You know, it's Friends and Family Day, so we want to thank you all for coming and worshiping with us. Our friends, we're all friends and family. But
that's fine. Got to get my assistant. He's going to read to us out of the scripture.
Number 6. But this I say, he which sow meat, sow eat, so sparingly shall reap also springly, and he reap he which. But this I say, he which sow need sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he which sow need bountifully shall reap also bountifully.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. And she can tell the anointed words out fast. So.
I know. Worship is a huge topic. There's really no way to talk about it or cover everything about worship in one setting. So my intent is to just give a brief overview on what worship is today. And then if Pastor Hill thinks I don't suck too bad, he'll allow me to do this again. And the next time that I come up, I'll preach or talk from worship from an Old Testament perspective, and then I'll go back to what worship is from a New Testament perspective. My title, if I were to give it a title, is Worship is a Matter of the Heart. Worship is a matter of the heart. Let's pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I need you to be my strength. Flow in and through me. Have your way, God. Your words, not my words. Your thoughts, not my thoughts. Your words to your people. God, you get the glory out of this morning. God, you've already gotten the glory, and we just gonna give it to you more. We love you and we praise you. We magnify and we lift you. We give you all the glory. We give you all the honor. We give you all the praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
If you don't mind, get your Bibles out and turn with me to St. John, chapter 4, verses 23 to 24. Thank you, Jesus. And it reads, "But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth." God is a spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Now, when I was younger, I thought that worship was slow songs and praise was the fast songs. That was my mind trying to process what worship was at a young age. And then when I became a teenager, somebody taught me that, well, you praise God for what he's done, and you worship him for who he is. And so I thought, okay, worship is when I love on God for who he is. But worship is so much bigger than just worshiping God for who he is. If all I did was worship God for who he is, you miss a whole gamut of how much you can worship God. However, let's start with the basics. Now, anybody knows I've been in ORU for the last 2-3 years almost. And I've been studying and writing research papers and studying and studying and studying about worship. And to get it all in one, I'm just like, okay, Jesus, how much did I say? How little I say? But I believe that this is what the Lord would have me to say. So let's start with the basics. Number one, the Bible is a Jewish book talking to Jewish people. They had no idea that we were going to need this book. So we have to understand it. We have to kind of put on the mind of what were their customs, what was going on in that time to understand what we need to get from it. Now, even though it is a Jewish book with Jewish customs, the Lord knew that we would need this book. So the provisions were made that as you read it, you can still get what it is you need to get from the word. But the first thing we need to understand is this is a Jewish book. Paul was a Jew. Jesus was a Jew. Moses was a Jew. They were all Jewish. Amen. So let's look at John chapter 4. In the beginning of the chapter, Jesus and there's a woman at the well. She's a Samaritan woman, and they're talking to each other. And it's kind of like a dialogue happening. Now, back in those days, Jews and Samaritans did not talk at all. That was not, you don't do that. And the reason that that was so was because there was a king of Assyria. I believe it's in 2 Kings chapter 17, verses 24, where the king of Assyria gets rid of the Israelites and he brings in the Samaritans. And so they worshiped all kinds of gods, and they just included God in the midst of all the other gods that they were worshiping. So they were not allowed in the temple. They were not, Jews didn't really have, you know, we don't talk to you. We have no conversations with you. So the fact that Jesus was even talking to a Samaritan was a huge deal. That's what I'm saying. So, and then we have to understand that there was enmity between Jews and Samaritans. So for Jesus to talk to this woman at the well, it was huge. It was very significant. We all know the story, but I'm refreshing our minds so we can get an understanding of what is happening in verses 23 to 24. So we have a clear picture of what's going on. So then he asks the same woman to get a husband, and she's like, well, I don't have a husband. And Jesus then responds, you're right, because you have already had five husbands, and the one that you're with now is not your husband. Once Jesus said this, the woman at the well knows that she is talking to a prophet. May I pause for a second and said, why does God have to pull our card before we understand what he's saying to us? Why does God have to prove to us that he's God? Why can't we just take him at his word at that moment? He just got to tell you and pull up your business and read everything that you've been through before you take him at his word. Why can't Jesus just say, I am God and I am he who has been sent, and we will just take him at his word and say, Lord, I trust you. Somebody turn to your neighbor and say, Lord, I trust you. Lord, I trust you and I lean on you. All right, I'm sorry. I'm going to take my time. So she begins talking about how they are supposed to worship in Jerusalem. This is a direct reflection of what worship was at the time. Worship unto God was like an exclusive Jewish club. Samaritans and Gentiles were not allowed to engage in worship with the Jews. So Jesus is responding to her that Jerusalem will soon no longer be the only place of worship, but there will come a time, and now is that time, that worship is not centered on location, worship is not centered on people, but worship is centered on being in the spirit and in truth. And when we do so, we get the presence of God in and through us moving, and we know that God is with us. So then we have to understand that worship is a matter of the heart. Why? In those days, worship was all about following all of the Jewish customs and doing them properly to please God. So what happened was, you have the Jews, and they have to, there's like different sacrifices that they have to do for different things, and then there's the holidays, and then there's the reading the scripture. They were reading the Torah to one another, but it was really just like I'm just going to do this because this is what I'm supposed to do, but their heart really wasn't in it. And so Jesus needed to come to kind of flip the script a little and help them to understand and notice. This isn't just about your customs. This ain't just about what we're doing on a day-to-day, but it's about your heart behind what you're doing. So Jesus was speaking on a time that was drawing nigh, where Samaritans and Gentiles alike would be able to partake in worship, and that time is now. So why would Jesus then say they that worship must worship in spirit and in truth? What does this mean? He was introducing a concept of how we are to engage with God in worship. See, the Jews were so bogged down by their laws that they followed the law with no thought as to why they were doing so. It was rituals and sacrifices that were almost mindless chores that had to be done consistently. You know, it is amazing how it seems that the times haven't changed as much. And we come to church because we're supposed to, or because you don't want a call from Pastor Hill, or some of us come to fulfill our religious obligations or to meet some sort of quota. But coming to church will not get you into heaven if you are not applying what you know the Lord is saying to you for you to do in your daily walk. There are a whole lot of people attending church every week that are going to be very disappointed when they meet Jesus, because he's going to say, "Depart from me, I know you not." If you are in the same place spiritually today that you were last year, then you're not growing. And how many of you know that if you're not growing, you're dying? I'm going to say it again. Some of us are in the same place that we were in a year ago. And if you're not growing, you're dying. Because that's what plants do. If plants aren't growing, you know, if I don't water it and if I don't do what a plant needs, then it's dying. So when was the last time you came to service looking forward to what God was going to do instead of planning on how fast you can leave? When was the last time you came to church with the expectation that God was going to do something amazing? See, the truth in worship is not only about the act. It's about your heart behind the act. The scripture says, worship the Father in spirit and in truth, because God is a spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. It does not say to those who are the loudest or the quietest. It says to worship the Father in spirit and in truth. Huh? Even Psalms 100 says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all you lands. It says, serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. It ain't about the noise. It ain't about the singing. It's about the joy that's behind the noise. It's about the way you come into his presence, about your heart. When you step into the presence of God, you just can't come to God any old kind of way. Even in the Old Testament, when the priests decided to go into the tabernacle, they walked in and they had to cleanse themselves. They had to examine themselves. And then after they examined themselves, they had to be clean and they had to offer sacrifices. And then they would walk in. And even as they were walking in, there were bells around their clothes, because if they did not examine themselves, they would drop dead in the presence of God. I was having a conversation with my friend, and she was trying to understand, why is it that we don't reverence God the same way that they did in the Old Testament? I said to her, because if we reap the same consequences that the people in the Old Testament reap, then we would be able to reverence him. What I'm saying is, if we saw the consequences of not reverencing God the way that we're supposed to immediately, then we would know to reverence him. If we knew that we didn't cleanse ourselves properly, or we didn't come to God properly, that we would drop dead in the moment, you would approach worship in a whole different manner. So you gotta change your approach, and you gotta come into the service with expectation, not for a certain song, not for a certain person that's up front, but because, Lord, I need you to do something different on the inside of me. Lord, I need you to change my heart. Lord, I need you to change my mind. Lord, I need thee. Oh, I need thee. Every hour, God, I need you. Hallelujah. Somebody say, thank you, Jesus. Now, even the scripture says, man looketh upon the outer appearance, but God looks upon the heart. People look at me and think, because I'm very demonstrative, that it means that I'm worshiping. And this is not true. Actually, my own personal time in worship is what's being reflected. I talk to God all day, every day, in every part of my life. There's no part of my life that God does not know about. If I don't feel like doing something, I tell him, Lord, I don't feel like doing it. If I'm tired, I'm like, Lord, I'm tired. If I'm hungry, Lord, I'm hungry. Lord, I don't know how I'm gonna get out of this. There's no part of my situation that is a surprise to God. Yes, he sees it, but he likes to hear it from my mouth. So I'm gonna talk to him in every facet and in every part of my day and begin to tell the Lord, Lord, this is what's going on and I need you to make a way. See, when I worship, it is out of an overflow of what God has been doing with me all week long. I do not know of a time when I did not look forward to being in the house of the Lord. I can't name a time when I wasn't excited about what God was gonna do, because anytime I know that I step foot in the house of the Lord, I know that I'm going to get something, whether it depends on the person up front or not, because I can go to God for myself and get exactly what I need from him. Hallelujah. So my first point is, you got to worship God in truth. I kind of flipped the scripture a little, because the second part says worship in truth, but I'm going to deal with truth first. Therefore, when you worship God, it must first be in truth. What does truth mean in this context? Well, truth in the Greek in this passage is the word alethinos, which means true in the sense of real, ideal, and genuine. So when you worship God, It must be real, ideal, and genuine. When your worship is real, ideal, and genuine, then it does not matter what song is being sung or who is up front. We know automatically that it is time to engage with the Holy Spirit. However, worshiping God in truth first starts with self-examination. Be honest with God. You know how He loves to hear what it is that we've got to say. God knows everything about me from me. He hears it all. And after I tell Him I do not feel like it, I tell Him that I love Him. And I know that my assignment is greater than how I feel. See, some Sundays I come to service and I don't always feel like it. I don't always feel like singing. Sometimes I would love to just sit and just lay prostrate on the floor. Or if anybody knows, when I come to Sister Deborah's prayer meeting, I'll come and just curl up in myself, because that's what I like to do. I like to just curl and sit in the presence of God and enjoy Him. I don't always want to sing, but I know that my assignment is greater than how I feel. And I can only imagine what a congregation of people would be like if we all came in with that mindset, that my assignment is greater than how I feel. So even though I don't feel like it, I'm going to walk into the service and I'm going to worship God, and I'm going to get my breakthrough, because somebody else on my row is depending on me to worship God a certain way so they can get their breakthrough. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So when we worship God, first you have to worship Him in truth. And then it begins with self-examination. Clean yourself when you're on your way here. If you had a conversation that you know you're not supposed to be having, ask the Lord for forgiveness. If you listen to a song that you're not supposed to be singing in, ask the Lord, Lord, forgive me. I know I'm not supposed to be listening. But don't just ask for forgiveness. Change that act so that you're not doing it on a consistent basis. Allow God to change your mindset. Allow Him to change how you act and how you do things, so that you can fully worship God in spirit and in truth. See, when you worship God in spirit and in truth, He changes how you act. He changes how you think. He changes how you will make certain decisions on a day-to-day basis. So when you worship God, first you have to examine yourself, and you worship God in truth. Somebody turn to your neighbor and say, worship God in truth. So the children of Israel immediately saw what was coming to them if they did not obey, or if their hearts were not toward the Lord. There was something that the children of Israel did not have that we have, and that's the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Lord, I thank You for Your Spirit. So the second point is, we must worship God in spirit. Now, there are two kinds of worship that we should be aware of. When one examines the New Testament to see what it says regarding worship and the assembly, we can see that the text delineates between two forms of worship. The first form is proskuneo, which is direct worship, the rendering of obedience to and prostration towards. And if you're not sure what I'm talking about, you can look it up in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verses 25. You can also look it up in Revelation chapter 4, verse 10, among many others. And then the second word is latria, which is indirect worship, which is the spiritual service rendered to fellow humans and to God. And if you're not sure about that, you can look up Romans 12 and 1. The New Testament never confines worship to the assembly, for anything we do in service to God is worship. In fact, very little is said regarding worship explicitly in the assembly. And the purpose of the assembly is primarily for the encouragement and the edification of the brethren. If you're not sure of that, you can look in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verses 26, and also in Hebrews chapter 10, verses 24 through 26. With direct worship also taking place, indeed, the passage we must often refer to demonstrate the authority of worship explains these things best, which is the verse that I picked, John chapter 4, verses 19 through 24, but mainly focusing on 23 through 24. The woman said unto Him, Sir, I perceive that Thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and You say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. But then Jesus said to her, Woman, believe Me. The hour cometh when neither in this mountain nor in Jerusalem shall you worship the Father. See, you worship that which you know not, but we worship that which we know. For salvation is from the Jews, but the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For such doeth the Father seek to be His worshipers. God is a spirit, and they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. See, this was the heart of the matter in their time. And it seems like the heart of the matter in our time. We've become so used to doing things a certain way. Only God can move in this song or when this preacher preaches, that we miss out on an opportunity to truly experience God. Sometimes I wonder if we could truly handle, if Jesus were to walk in and to say some of the things that he said, would we believe him or would we call him a heretic? I wonder if Jesus were to walk in, would we kick him out because he doesn't fit what our preconceived notions of what worship or what the word is supposed to be. I wonder if he walked in and said, so you gotta eat my body and drink my blood. What would we say? Would we respond the way that the disciples responded? Would we respond or would we say, oh, you can't eat me, but would we be like, the blood? I thank God for Pastor Hill because he is always willing to try just about anything just to see whatever will work. You see, Jesus was trying to get people to understand the heart behind the law. Worship is a matter of the heart, and it must be done in spirit and in truth. See, worship in the Greek is proskuneo, and the word itself, proskuneo, is made up of two other Greek words, which are pros and kuneo. And pros means towards, and kuneo means to kiss. So when you're worshiping, you're really, I'm kissing towards him. So the definition of proskuneo is to do reverence to. This is the most frequent word rendered to worship. In this passage, it is used as an act of homage or reverence. And sometimes I feel like we come to church, and this is me, we come to church just to check off another thing on the list of things to do. We just want to get it done. Oh yes, I went to church this Sunday, so I'm definitely going to heaven because I went to church. But can you imagine how our worship would transform if we did it in the reverence? So when your heart is reverential, then you go somewhere your flesh cannot take you. When you completely give yourself to God, he fills you up on what you need. There are many reasons why I worship God, but I mostly worship him because I love him. So because I choose to love him through how I worship, remaining in constant communication with God is easy. Then when I study his word, he communicates back to me. See, when I worship God, it doesn't come out of an obligation. It's not out of somebody telling me that I've got to worship, or this is what I'm supposed to do, or this is how it's supposed to look or sound like. I'm worshiping God because I love him first. If God never did another thing, he's already been so good to me. So I just have to praise him, and I have to magnify him, and I have to give his name all the glory, and I have to give his name all the honor, because he is just so good. Has anybody ever just had a moment where God, if you never did another thing, I will open up my mouth and I will bless the Lord at all times, because his praises shall continue to be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord, and the humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord and he heard me, and he delivered me from all my fears. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusts him. Lord, I put my heart behind what I do. I put my actions behind what I do. Lord, I give it all to you. Somebody give it all to him. He desires to hear your praise. He desires to hear your worship. Somebody say hallelujah. Somebody say hallelujah. Worship is a matter of the heart. We should be so far along in our worship that somebody doesn't have to tell you what to do. That somebody doesn't have to explain to you what's going on. It should be an automatic. God, I give it to you. God, I surrender it all to you. God, I lay at your feet. God, I bow down before you. God, I reverence you because he desires. Do you know that this is the only thing that God doesn't give to himself? This is the one thing that we can give to God. He don't need no rocks to cry out for me. I will cry out. Chapter 6, verses 5, it says, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 29, it says, but if from thence thou shalt seek the Lord thy God, you shall find him. And if you seek him with all your heart and with all thy soul, how often do we seek the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might, with all your strength, with everything that is within you? I will bless the Lord. I will bless the Lord. See, the children of Israel, their form of worship was obedience. They were obedient to the Lord. But in the New Testament, we have the formal introduction, because he was already there, but the formal introduction of the Holy Spirit. So we have access to something that everybody doesn't have. We have access to something. And if you take advantage of it, he will pour it and download into you what it is that you need. I'm finished, but we just gonna take this time and we just gonna worship. That's all I felt the Lord leading me to do, is that we gonna talk about worship, we gonna do it too. So I'm gonna invite everybody to stand. Everybody, kids too. Don't let these kids fool you, they can worship too. Everybody with your hands lifted, eyes closed, open up your mouth and tell the Lord something you haven't already told. If you want to go in your heavenly language, you can go there too. Kurabashe, kurabasi. Kurabaye, lelelelokose. Kurabaye, lelelelokose. Oh, rabashe, kurabasi. He desires to hear your worship. He desires, let it come from your heart. Let it come from your heart. Kurabashe, rabaresia. Lord, I bless your name. Lord, I give your name the full glory. I give your name the praise. You've been too good, Lord. Lord, forgive me of anything that's not like you. Forgive my heart if I had any thoughts or actions that were untoward, that were not a reflection of who you are, God. Something. Tell him that you love him. Tell him that you need him. us to experience the newness of you. Lord, we want to just glorify you, Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus that anyone that may be tired or that may be weak, that you will be our strength, God, in the name of Jesus.
Let's pray. Everybody open up your mouth and begin to pray. You know, this is the most uncomfortable part because they want you to look at them and walk up to them and grab them. We ain't doing that. Today is the day that you get it. I'd be running up here if it were me. Because it's something that I need. His presence is something I've got to have. You can't live without him. I can't move without him. I can't function without him. There's nothing that can be done outside of the Holy Spirit moving on the inside of me. There's one more. And you're looking at me and expecting me to call you out. I'm not doing that. If you know the Holy Spirit is talking to you, you need to be up here. If you know that the Holy Spirit is dealing with you about your walk with God, let this be the day that change your mind. Let this be the day that you change your lifestyle. Let this be the day that your actions and your words change. There's no rush. We're waiting on the Holy Spirit.
Thank you. all that new. Amen. We heard the word today. Amen. Spirit just gave it to me to release Sister Brenda in her own ministry. Not just singing ministry, but in the teaching and preaching ministry. And I felt like it would be no better time than. Amen. The month that we had set aside, amen, to focus on praise and worship. How many believe the breakthrough is here? Amen. How many believe the breakthrough is here? When I see things happening like this morning, even before the speaker came, Sister Jessica could even give the announcements. Sister Tia could even get back to her office. Amen. When you see things like that, you know that this is not just a normal Sunday. Amen. Bible says that all that men would praise the Lord for his goodness. Everybody just repeat with me. All that men would praise the Lord for his goodness. Amen. And for his wonderful works to the children of men. Isn't God wonderful? Amen. At the redeemer of the Lord, say, the Lord is good and his what? Mercy endureth forever. Lift your hands and the Lord is good. And his mercy endureth forever. Let the redeemed. Turn to somebody and just say, let the redeemed. Let him say so. Yeah. Who? He has redeemed. How many have been redeemed? How many have a son the angels can say? Been redeemed? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, yes. We're going to keep drawing water, drawing praise and worship out of all of God's anointing until this place begins to flow over with the anointing. It's not about me. It's not about just the ministers alone. Amen. It's about the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. The Bible said, let them sacrifice with the sacrifice of thanksgiving. And let them declare his works with rejoicing. Oh, how many want to declare his works with rejoicing? How many want to be glad in the Lord? Hallelujah. How many want to come before his presence with singing? Hallelujah. Serving the Lord with what? Gladness. Coming for his presence with singing. The Lord is good. Amen. We're going to see some mighty things. It's not going to be just through, amen, with ones that we think is going to come through. Amen. I was blessed this morning. Oh, yes. Amen. I was blessed. Sister Brenda did it out of her heart. Yes. Amen. The Lord just said, just mentioned it to me and just said that, amen, she's one of the people, which, well, one of the ministers that's a good example of doing it with all of your heart. Bible says, whatever you do, do it with all of your what? Might. How many can say amen? Amen. Do it with your whole heart. How many can say amen? Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all. Everybody can just say and all. Wouldn't it be a turnaround? Amen. If everybody just did it with all their heart. All that is within them. Oh, praising God for the abundance of all things. Amen. We're just going to continue to move forward in praise and worship. Amen. Blessing the Lord. We're just so happy for Sister Brenda. How many of you are blessed? Amen. 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 She's been probably getting high on her worship all the time, but I don't think it was kind of like what she did today. Amen. She went all out, all the way. God used her, and we appreciate the Spirit of the Lord. Amen. We just want to be a blessing, and Sister Deborah is going to come and promote. If there ever were time, if y'all have any inkling of what God is about to do, you wouldn't miss next Saturday morning. Amen. Now, I'm serious. Sister Jessica been coming on Saturday. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Now, some of the children began to break down this morning, some of them. Wow. You know, that's the anointing. Hallelujah. How many can envision all of the children praying in the Holy Ghost, prophesying out on the floor, prostrate before the Lord? How many can envision that? Amen. Her sister Denise Dunn says, if adults got to lead out. Amen. If adults, though, the Bible says, Hey, hallelujah. Yeah, if we don't praise, then what? The rocks will cry out. If the adults won't praise, then what? The kids are going to cry. Glory. Amen. Sister Denise and challenge us tremendously. We're going to have to touch on that next Sunday. Everybody have a part in this, because when your turn comes, you don't know how the Lord is going to use you. Everybody just bow their heads. Father, we thank you for the gift of grace. Lord, grace is doing for us what we never would have been able to do for ourselves. It's the sum total of all that you have done for us through Christ, and what you are presently doing for us through the Holy Ghost. Your grace is sufficient. You're able to cause all grace to abound toward us, so we will have sufficiency in everything. Father, we give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Okay, so Sister Deborah is going to come at this time. Hallelujah. Thank you. God bless you. All right, Sister Deborah. Evangelist. Prophetess.
Praise the Lord, saints. That was an awesome word. I enjoyed the entire service this morning. Just look for more, Sister Brianna. You know, that's just a drop in the bucket of what God is going to do for you and through you. And we just want to encourage you that this Saturday will be the last Saturday we will pray before the election. That's one thing we need to be in prayer about. If you don't know that's serious, you may want to talk to somebody, because it's serious. And we really want to pour out our hearts on Saturday for that. Also, Sister Jessica said the 10th month, and I began to think 10 fingers, 10 toes. And that means things are being set in order. That's the word 10, the number 10 in the Bible means complete, perfection, maturity. And so we've been doing this for a while. We didn't wait until a tragedy happened to start a prayer vigil. We started right at the beginning of the month, of the year, excuse me. So I want to encourage you to come on out. It's praying time. And I've been working on this for over a year. I've been working on my master's degree in intercessory prayer. And as I'm studying the material, I realize there's so much in a person's life that really needs to be dealt with just to get a breakthrough in prayer. I'm amazed at the entanglements and the soul ties and the bondages that really hinder people from going all the way with God, like Sister was talking about, even in worship. So I want to encourage you to come Saturday. We really need to cry out for this nation. We really need to cry out for our state, our community. We really need to seek the Lord. So let's come. Let's come this Saturday from 8 a.m. until noon and really allow the Lord to just pour through us, not only an intercessory prayer, but the things he needs to do inside of us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's come out on Saturday. I believe we'll have a musician out. Check that out so that we can really go in and do some more praise and worship, as well as prayer and intercession. God bless you. I'm so happy to see my pastor today.
Everybody standing on your feet. God bless you. Thank you so much for your patience today. We stayed a little longer than we normally stay, but I believe that the time was well spent. Everybody say amen. Praise the Lord. Let us praise him. Let us praise him. Praise him. Praise him. God bless you. God over you. Amen.